Good morning, City Reach Church family, and to our live stream family. We want to thank you so much for joining this morning for Sunday service. I'm so excited for what we have planned today, and more importantly, what God has planned for us today. So we want to thank you again for just being a part of that today. I want to open up today with our prayer focus of the week. Also, I want to follow that up with our verse of the week as well, because it's so important for us guys to continue to maintain those things that we should be doing daily. Praying and being in the Word of God. Amen. So the prayer focus of the week is this. Lord, you are the reason for all of our joy. Help us to fix our eyes on you when our circumstances are painful and hard. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I love this prayer so much simply because it gets right to the point. The point that number one, Lord, we realize you are our joy. And number two, God, you are our joy. I just want to remind you of that today, that you don't have to overthink things when it comes to praying out to the Lord. If you have a need, just let him know that need. If you're hurting, just let him know you're hurting. Remember, when you ask for help, God hears you and he will respond to that. I also want us now to take just a moment to go over our verse of the week, which comes from Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. It says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all that he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. As I just think about this verse for a moment, and I see where it tells us to pray about everything, I want to remind you, church, that even though we cannot physically come together, we can still pray together. So on Tuesday mornings, I want to remind you that we have 24 hours that we designate as a church to pray for our families, to pray for our city, to pray for our government, to pray for our nation, and to pray for the world. It's our time to say, God, we will stand at the gates and we will be on guard. And I want to encourage you to not stop that, but to continue to do that. I also know that we're not right now meeting physically for midweek prayer service. But I do want to encourage you, we can still and should pray. And so I pray that even with your family, that on Wednesday nights at 6:30, you would gather together, that you would maybe take some time to just worship and praise the Lord and go into a time of prayer, because that's what Laura and I, we're going to continue to do that. We're going to continue to take that time and continue to pray, because nothing that is happening right now takes away from what we can still do as believers in Christ. Church, I want to encourage you in that. And now, right there where you are, would you just take in a deep breath? Just breathe in the presence of God as he starts to just fall on you right where you're at. That you would just let the Holy Spirit have the freedom to begin to move. And let us join together in praise and worship to our God.
There's a longing that reaches past the storm. There's an answer to every question mark.
Yes.
There's a name. There's a
hope. Right now, church, I just want to encourage you right now. Stand, raise your hands up right now. Just praise God for who he is.
An ember ready
in the name
for
of Jesus, let us
flame.
Magnify that name together in our praise. Proclaim it right now, Jesus. thank you for loving me like you do.
Triumphs over fear. There's a laughter that wipes away all tears. There's a presence that changes
atmosphere. You feel the atmosphere changing right where you are right now. Just receive it. Just let it come. His kingdom come. His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So right there, your living room, your dining room, your bathroom, your point wherever you are. God's presence come, welcome you in. Let it just consume you right now.
Every heart, I worship you. worship you. I worship you.
Protecting you, providing you.
You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship. I worship you. Hey, we make a miracle walking, promise keeper, light in the darkness. That is who you are. Hey, we make a miracle walking, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who. You wipe away all tears. You mend the broken heart. You're the answer to it all. Jesus, you wipe away all tears. You mend the broken heart. You're the answer to it all. To it all. I worship you. You are here, meeting every need. I worship you. I worship you. Oh, de de motion de amazeke ane.
Church, what an amazing time of worship. And I want to encourage you right now just to continue in the worship that you're in. Just take a moment, just for one more time, just reaching out and giving God a hug and letting Him just hug you right back right now. What I love about being in the presence of God is that there's no hurry. We can stay there as long as we want to because God enjoys us. So I just want to encourage you today, even after the service today, just continue to just embrace and walk in God's presence today, whether it's just with yourself or with your family. Just continue to just. As we get ready to get into the Word this morning, if you have your Bibles, I want to encourage you right now to turn to Esther chapter 2. Today we're going to be reading part of a story of a young lady. Life basically was simple. She was a nobody. That people had told her that she would never be a somebody. And that she would never be loved. Her mom and dad passed away. She had been raised by an uncle. Life had not been easy for her. But in this story, what we find is someone who not only goes from being a nobody, but we find someone who is loved, and not just loved by anybody, but loved by a king. And that is the story of Esther. And I believe that is our story. Many of you who have given your life to Christ know this and understand that you are truly loved, not just by God, you are loved by a king. And yet at the same time, as we think about how much God loves us, I think about the world today where they are at. Do they really truly know who loves them? Do they really truly know how much God loves them? I think that today it's important for us just to take a few moments, be reminded together what it means to be loved, not just by anybody, but by a king. Esther chapter 2. Esther chapter 2, we're going to be reading verses 7 through 18 right now. Esther chapter 2, verses 7 through 18. And the word of God says this. This man had a very beautiful and lovely young cousin, Hadassah, who was also called Esther. When her father and mother had passed away, Mordecai adopted her into his family and raised her as his own daughter. As a result of the king's decree, Esther, along with many other young women, were brought to the king's harem at the fortress of Susa and placed in Haggai's care. Haggai was very impressed with Esther and treated her kindly. He quickly ordered a special menu for her and provided her with beautiful treatment. He also assigned her 7 maids, specially chosen from the king's palace, and he moved her and her maids into the best place in the harem. Esther had not told anyone of her nationality or of her family background, because Mordecai, her uncle, had directed her not to do so. But every day, Mordecai would take a walk around the courtyard of the harem to find out about Esther and what was happening with her. Before each young woman was taken to the king's bed, she was given the prescribed 12 months of beauty treatments, 6 months with oil of myrrh, followed by 6 months with special perfumes and ointments. And when it was time for her to go to the king's palace, she was given her choice of whatever clothing or jewelry she wanted to take from the king's harem. That evening, she was taken to the king's private rooms, and the next morning she was brought to the second harem, where the king's wives lived. And there she would be under the care of Shastia, the king's eunuch in charge of the concubine. She would never go to the king again unless he had especially enjoyed her and requested her by name. Esther was the daughter of Abihail, who was Mordecai's uncle. Mordecai had adopted his younger cousin Esther. And when it was Esther's turn to go to the king, she accepted the advice of Haggai, the eunuch in charge of the harem. She asked for nothing except what he suggested, and she was admired by everyone who saw her. Esther was taken to King Xerxes at the royal palace in early winter of the 7th year of his reign. And the king loved Esther more than any of the other young women. He was so delighted with her that he set the royal crown on her head and declared her queen instead of the previous queen, Vashti. And to celebrate this occasion, he gave a great banquet in Esther's honor for all of his nobles and officials, declaring a public holiday for the province and giving generous gifts. What a beautiful story. In fact, for many of us who have heard of these romances, whether it's been through Disney or through books we've read, we kind of look at this like a fairy tale. Like, could this really happen? Could a young woman who was nobody actually be chosen, not only to be loved, to be loved by a king? The fact is that this is a true story, and that in this story, she finds true love. I want you to know today that God loves you. And not only does he love you, but you were not just randomly chosen. As we look at these scriptures and we look at the women who were taken, they just didn't take anyone. These were people who were specifically selected because it was believed that these women would please the king. If we look at the history of kings, it would be by the king's order that if something was done and it didn't please the king, then that person would be executed. That's how important it was to make sure that the king would be pleased. Someone had seen Esther, and someone had looked at her beauty and realized that this was someone that they truly believed that the king could love. I want you to know today that God loves you so much. created you, because he designed you. And because he's your creator and your designer, he loves you. Even in this world today, you may look at yourself, you may look at your life, and you may say, you know what, Pastor, you don't realize that I haven't accomplished anything. I'm not where I would want to be. I'm not the husband I want to be or the wife I want to be. I'm not the mother or father I want to be. I don't have the job I ever dreamed of. I haven't accomplished anything. Can I just say to you right now that none of those things that have mattered to us matter to God. What matters to God most in these moments is that you know that he loves you. And he chooses to love you. Because by loving you, it brings pleasure not only to you, but pleasure to himself. I think of this verse that Jesus spoke to his disciples. Out of John 15:16, he said, "You didn't choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit, so that the Father will give you whatever you would ask using my name." As I think about Esther and the fact that she could have asked for anything, that she was advised to be careful in what she asked for. And she took that advice and she truly believed that everything that she needed had already been provided. It's so important for us to realize it as well, that as we think about love and we think about all of us desiring to want to be loved, God has provided that to us. John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting." It's a joy to know that not only can you be loved by a king, but it starts by knowing that the king has chosen you. Along with that choice that God has made to love us, I also want to remind you that you are beautiful. You are fearfully and wonderfully made, because mighty are God's works. And when God created you, he said these words, "It is good." It's important for you and I to realize that not only were we created, but we were created beautifully. And the reason that we were created beautifully is that we were designed for a purpose. Purpose to shine brightly and resonate to the rest of the world the love of God that he has given us. Now it can resonate through you to love someone else. I think of the passage of scripture that just continues to remind us. In Isaiah 52:7, it says, "How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of the messengers who bring good news, the good news of peace and salvation, the news that the God of Israel reigns." We praise God this morning. We praise him because we know he is the one who reigns. In a world that is lost in confusion and chaos right now, we know that our God is still in control. And we can give God glory and honor for that, but not only giving him glory and honor for him being in control, but also for knowing that in the midst of it, we still have a purpose. And that purpose is to bring the good news to all those around us. What a great opportunity we have. We may not be able to go door to door. We may not be able to gather in groups physically right now. You can pick up your phone. You can send that email finally. Maybe just simply send that text. That just let someone know that you're thinking of them. You're praying for them. That you love them because God loves them. Maybe there's somebody out there that you don't know yet that maybe just found out that they have the virus. Or maybe there's someone out there right now who knows someone who has that virus and they are near and dear to them. And they're going through that pain. They're going through that suffering. They're going through that grief. What a great opportunity for us as the church to be able to recognize that we are loved. And not only loved by a king. And we can take that same news, that great news, and we can take it to someone else and let them know how much. But we also need to remember that while we are loved by a king, and while we need to remember how beautifully we are created in the sight of God, we still have a choice. We have a choice to decide whether we're going to receive that love God wants to give us, or whether or not we're going to deny it. And whether or not we say, well, I'm not worthy, I don't deserve it, or you don't know what I've done. Can I just say this to you right now? That it doesn't matter what you've done, because Jesus didn't die just for us. He died so that sin nature could be completely destroyed. Can I just say to you right now, if you've been struggling, if you've been battling, whatever it is, you don't have to say anything to me or anyone else. You can just talk to God about it. If you are struggling and you are hurting and you feel like you're just a disappointment to God right now, I want you to reach out and just let God know how you feel. Because in the midst of letting God know how you feel, He's got something for you you don't even realize yet. I call it a letting down. I have seen a show that my wife watches that is called Yes to the Dream. And they go around, and I guess these bridesmaids and future brides go and take a look at all these dresses, trying to find the perfect one. But at the end of the day, no matter how long it takes for them to go through this arduous task of picking out a dress, at some point, the bride has to say, yeah. And we are the bride of Christ. And God wants us to wear the dress that He has picked out for us. Not just because He is worthy, but because we are worthy because of who He is. Because He loves us so much. In Ephesians chapter 5. Verses 22 through 27, we see the example of this, of God loving the church like a bride. And He uses the example of a husband and wife. It starts by saying, for wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For a husband is the head of his wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the Savior of his body, the church. As the church submits to Christ, we have to understand we're the bride. We're the wife. God is coming to us and saying that now we, as a wife does to her husband, as a church, we need to submit to Christ. It also says, so you wives should submit to your husbands in everything. I know you may be looking at your situation right now and saying, Pastor, you don't know my husband. You don't know that how he treats me or the things that he says to me. And I can tell you that I truly understand that, because I used to be that kind of husband. I wasn't kind. I wasn't nice. I had a lot of anger from past pains that my wife didn't even know anything about. I was unable to love her like I needed to. I want to tell you what my wife did is she submitted knowing that God was greater. And knowing that His love was greater. And knowing that His love could make a difference in my life. And so she kept praying and she kept believing. And for 20 years, my wife believed and prayed that one day God would get a hold of my mind. Praise God that in December of 2008, finally. And I said yes to the dress. I submitted to Him. And in submitting to Him, I was able to start becoming the father and the husband that I needed to be in my home. God can do the same thing for you. You've got to lift up that spouse, whether it's a husband or a wife. You need to lift them up, give them to God, and let God's love do what only His love can do. Remember, our physical love, our emotional love, is limited by our expectation, but not with God. Because His love comes unconditionally. He puts the expectation not on you, but on Himself to say that He's going to love you the way that you need to be loved. How amazing is that? We have a God, that there is a King that would love even when we feel like we're nothing. As we go on and continue to look at this, there's also an example set to the husband. For husband, this means love your wives, just as Christ loved the church. He gave us His life because He gave His life for her. To make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. There it is again, just reminding us of what our role is. It's to love. And it's in that love that we're willing to give, because it says there that he gave his life for the church. Why? Because he loved her. In the same way, God loves you. That is why he sent his son. That is why he made the sacrifices made. That is why you can still go to him even when you fail and you stumble and you fall. You can still go in your sin before God and confess your sin and know that he will forgive your sin and cleanse you from it. No one loves like that, because no one is able to love it. But I want to encourage everyone that you are worth loving. More importantly, the King finds you worth loving. As we close out the scripture, it says he did this to prefer to himself as a glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. I think to myself of how I felt before I came to know Jesus Christ. I felt so dirty inside. I felt so unclean. But I'm so thankful for a God who literally grabbed me out of the mess and out of the mud and pulled me from it and said, George, I'll wash you. I'll cleanse you. There's no greater love than that. That physical contact that God can do for us by literally reaching inside of us, washing. As I think of the church today, I think of everything that God is doing just right now. We're not able to congregate, but we're understanding that, hey, the church is never about a building. The church is about us going out and just being the church. That we're not limited by four walls. That we literally can go out to our communities right now. And we can share the love I'm sharing with you. We can tell them the story, just like Esther told her story. Now you have that story to tell someone else, and that can become their story. Here's what Peter said, the Apostle John said in Revelations chapter 19, verse 7. He said, let us be glad and rejoice, and let us give honor to him, for the time has come for the wedding feast of the Lamb, and his bride has prepared herself. How does a bride prepare herself? What I have discovered by talking to my wife, because I never knew what it was to be a bride. I was the groom. But one day I sat down with her and I asked her to tell me what goes on in the heart and mind of a bride as it gets closer and closer. What is it that brings them to this place where they work as hard as they do, because there's so much that they do to prepare themselves? And she said this to me, and I think it's so powerful. She said, I prepared myself with everything I had because I loved you with everything I had. And I believe that you love me. And I say this to you today. In this world, people will disappoint you. People will let you down. Sometimes you'll get hurt. Sometimes you'll get that feeling of not feeling loved, feeling unworthy. It's simply just people's expectations. And I tell you today that God doesn't work that way. That he loves you because he chose to love you. And he didn't just do it in a moment. He did it from the beginning. From the beginning, he has loved you. Today, and everything that we're going through together, not just as a church, in our communities, in our state, in our nation, in this world, the answer is still God's love. So we, church, will remember how much we're loved and to realize who loves us. Will make all the difference. Being able to walk in victory and know that even though our enemy will try to come against us and destroy us, he can never separate. as you continue to read Esther. And I just encourage you, read chapter 7 of Esther. In fact, read the rest of the book. It's an amazing story. I just want to direct you to chapter 7. And the reason for that is I want you to see what happened. Because of the king's love for Esther, there is an executive officer who tries to undermine Esther, knowing that she is a Jew. And more importantly, knowing that her uncle is a Jew. And so he wants to obliterate all of the Jews. And he sets up a devious plan to destroy the Jewish nation. But because of the love that the king had for Esther, because of the love of God that Esther had, knowing that God loved her no matter what, a whole nation would be saved because nobody got loved by it. More importantly, she was loved by it. So we close today. I know there may be somebody who's joined us today that may say, this is the first time I've ever come on, Pastor George, and I'm hearing you talk about God's love, and I hear you talking to the church. Never been a part of anything like that. Pastor George, I just want you to know right now, I just don't know that God can love me. I want to tell you that part of the vision of our of the church is that people matter. That no matter who you are, no matter where you're from, and no matter what you've done, not only do you matter to us, but you matter more to God. God loves you with all of his heart. And you need to remember that he's the one who created you in the first place. And maybe you haven't made the right choices that have directed you down a path to come closer to God. But it doesn't take away from the fact that God loves you. So today, I want to invite you to come and know that Father. I think of Paul as he speaks to us in Romans. He said, if we confess our sins, we are willing to just admit and confess our sins, repent of our sins. And if we will believe in Jesus Christ, not in Jesus Christ who died on the cross for our sins, but believe in a Jesus who was raised from the dead. The Bible says if you would believe that, you will be saved. So today I encourage you, right where you are, to just simply put out your hands before the Lord. Repent of your sins. Just ask God right now to forgive you for those sins. I promise you, because of how much he loves you, you will be forgiven. And the reason I know that is because you've already. After you repent, then just tell him that you believe. You believe that he did send Jesus Christ to come and die for you. That you do believe that God had the power to raise him from the dead, so that we would know what it means to have life. And not only just any life, but life. I encourage you today to take that time. It won't take long. You'll spend more time afterwards just literally being in the presence of God and letting him love on you than in the words that you'll speak to him. But it takes you believing that, believing it in your heart. But if you do, I promise you, God keeps his promises, you will be saved. If you do that today, I would encourage you to go onto our Facebook page and just let us know about your decision. Let us know that today you gave your life to Jesus Christ. We would love to get into contact with you, follow up with you, just to encourage you and to let you know what the next steps are for you as a new believer. I also want to speak for just a moment now to the believers. Just remind you that as much as we know that God loves us, let us never get satisfied in that. Let us always want to know. Go deeper with God's love. The deeper we go with God's love, the more we will walk in what he's called us. Through that love, that we will be empowered to not just love somebody, but to love anyone. Let us pray and ask God to give us that desire he had to reach all men with salvation. Let us also pray that we will have that same desire. That same. Finally, I just want to encourage all of the body just to continue to stay connected. I've been seeing texts and emails going out. I know some people call me to let me know that folks have been in contact with them and just checking in on them. Church, I just want to continue to encourage you to do that. Go down the list this week. Many of you have a church directory. Just go down the list and maybe call one or two people. Every day, just call one or two people. Just say, I just want to say hello. Find out how you're doing. But it's so important for us to remember the only way that we will see God's hand move mightily through us when we realize who loves us. Remember, you and I, all of us, are loved by you. A wonderful service we had this morning. So good to just be able to get together and to worship the Lord together and hear a word from the Lord together. Would you agree, babe? And, you know, I'm so glad to have you with me this morning to help me just end the service with our today. So I just want to welcome you and thank you for your help.
Glad to be here. All right. So we got a couple of announcements. So right now, through Friday, April 10th, the offices will still remain closed. And so if you are trying to get a hold of us, you can reach Pastor George at 575-644-3973, and that is his cell phone. So if you are in need of anything or have any questions or just a prayer request, please give us a call and he will answer the phone.
Yeah, and if I don't answer the phone, I do have a voicemail. I please want to just encourage you, please leave your name and number and what you need so that we can stay connected together. And I promise you that we will get back to you as soon as possible. Also, I just want to let you know that I do have voicemail, so please leave me a voicemail with your name, number, and what it is that you need, and I promise you that we will get back to you as soon as possible. You can also text us, and also reach us on our Facebook page at City Reach Church Los Lunas. I just want to remind you all that there are several ways in which you can stay connected to us, and we do want to stay connected to you. Please make sure that you use those avenues to reach out to us, and we look forward to staying in contact with you as well. I also want to let you know that as we speak of needs, and we know that right now with things that are going on, there are people that are out of work, people who are sick and not able to get out. If you have a specific need where maybe you need some groceries, need someone to take you to the pharmacy, maybe take you to a doctor's appointment, I want you to know that we have a Well Cure ministry that's run by Brother Jose and Sister Diana Maestas. They're wonderful, wonderful people, and they want to stay connected with you as well, and we want to help you any way that we can. And so we posted their phone numbers there on the screen for you so that you can know how to get in contact with Jose and Diana. And we just want you to know that if you have a need, we're here to help in any way that we can. We also want you to know if you know someone else that may be in need, even if they don't come to the church, but they do have a need, please get in contact with them and let us know. We want to help this community right now just get through this season any way possible. And so, again, you know, people matter to us. And because they matter, we're willing to do whatever we can. And so please make sure that you get in touch with Jose and Delma if there is a need, and they'll be more than happy to assist you with that. Also wanted to let you know that even though our midweek prayer meetings right now are postponed until the directive is lifted for five or less people to gather together, we still want to be connected through prayer. And so we are working very hard right now to set that up so that we can gather together during the week for times of prayer. And as soon as we get all of that ironed out, we will be posting that to you via text, email, and also Facebook. So you'll know the days and times that we can come together virtually. Thank you, Ray. Yeah. She reminded me of that earlier, virtually, and I just need to remind you that again, this is through virtual contact. So, but we still want to stay connected, and we can and we should. And so we'll get you more information on that. But just want you to know that in the meantime, we are praying for you and praying with you and praying over you. And we encourage every one of you to let people know that. Get a hold of people and let them know that they're being thought of, that you're thinking of them and praying for them. Because at the end of the day, prayer is a very powerful thing. Prayer does change our situation. Amen, honey?
All right, and so last but not least, tithes and offerings. So since the offices are closed through April 10th, we are not able to have like a drop-off location, but there are a couple options that you do have for your tithes and offerings. You can go online to New Mexico Ministry Network, and I got my phone so that I can tell you the different steps because it is a little bit, I don't want to say steps, but there are quite a few steps. So under New Mexico Ministry Network, if you go to the Give tab, and then it'll pop up a screen that'll say you can click to donate or click to purchase. You want to click to donate. Under the click to donate, you're going to go to the other tab. You'll fill in your amount. And if you scroll at the bottom, you can either set it up as reoccurring so that it automatically comes out and you don't have to worry about it, or you can do a one-time gift. If you do the one-time gift or recurring, it'll have you fill out some information. And at the bottom, before you finalize, there's a comment box. You want to either specify City Reach Church, Los Lunas, or Pastor George and I have an account code, and it's 124GB. So you want to specify. If you give under that other without specifying, it will go into just a general pot, as you will, because of the fact that this is the network accounting system. So you want to make sure that you do specify for City Reach Church Los Lunas. The other way that we have is if you either want to contact us, we can either pick up tithes and offerings from you, or if you're out and about and you want to just drop it on by the house, you can let us know. And we appreciate all your love and support and prayers.
Absolutely. Absolutely, babe. And again, thank you for just being here today and for your love. To me, to this ministry, so grateful to have you. And, you know, God's going to see us through this like he always does. Amen. Amen. And we want you to know that, so even though right now we can't meet, and I know for some of you, you may be saying, Pastor, when are we going to be able to get together? You know, right now that hasn't been specifically outlined as a specific date just yet, but we will keep you posted. We will let you know. But in the meantime, let us just continue to use these other avenues that God has given us and created for us to be able to stay in touch with one another, continue to love one another, and continue to grow closer to him. Amen. Why don't we close in a word of prayer? Would that be all right? Father, we just thank you and praise you, God, for the service today. We thank you for the time we had to just worship you and praise you. Thank you for the time we had, God, to get into your word, God, to be reminded what your word tells us, God, to be encouraged, to be edified and empowered. And God, we just thank you for the good work that you are doing in us, through us, for all of us. And we just continue to seek your face and continue to just trust you, God. We continue to believe that, God, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We do believe, God, that, God, you will meet every one of our needs. God, that you will, God, continue to love on us, God. And I just pray that today, again, the message that we received from you about your love and remembering who loves us would resonate in us today to know that no matter what, God, nothing. We give you glory and honor and praise for today. Bless the people, God, where they are. Continue, God, to just magnify your favor, your blessings, your love to them in a mighty way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
God bless you all. Have a wonderful day.